See, my servant shall prosper. He shall be exalted and lifted up, and shall be very high. Just as there were many who were astonished at him, so marred was his appearance beyond human semblance, and his form beyond that of mortals. So he shall startle many nations. Kings shall shut their mouths because of him, for that which has not been told them, they shall see, and that which they had not heard, they shall contemplate. Who has believed what we have heard? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a young plant, and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by others, a man of suffering and acquainted with infirmity, and as one from whom others hid their faces, he was despised, and we held him of no account. Surely he has borne our infirmities and carried our diseases. Yet we accounted him stricken, struck down by God and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the punishment that made us whole, and by his bruises we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have all turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed, and he was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, like a sheep that before its shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. By a perversion of justice, he was taken away. Who could have imagined his future? For he was cut off from the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people. They made his grave with the wicked, and his tomb with the rich, although he had no violence, and there was no deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him with pain. When you make his life an offering for sin, he shall see his offspring, and shall prolong his days. Through him the will of the Lord shall prosper. Out of his anguish he shall see light. He shall find satisfaction through his knowledge. The righteous one, my servant, shall make many righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore I will allot him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he poured out himself to death and was numbered with the transgressors. Yet he bore the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressors.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Tonight in Bethlehem, the doors are closed at the Church of the Nativity, which we believe to be the birthplace of Jesus, and across Manger Square, the Omar Ben Kar Tab Mosque stands completely empty over fears of the coronavirus. Instead of giving his annual Palm Sunday message from the balcony over St. Peter's Square last Sunday, the Pope delivered his message by a video link. One of the greatest scriptural foundations of Christianity is Jesus saying in Matthew's gospel, "Whenever two or three are gathered together in my name, there I am among them." But in a world with a public health crisis like the one currently posed by COVID-19, whenever two or more Christians come together to share prayers and hugs and coffee and the bread and wine of Holy Communion, there among us could also be the coronavirus. celebrations of the Jewish holiday of Passover this past week were downsized greatly by many Jewish families. And the practice of Islam has been hit even harder in coronavirus-stricken Iran, where Friday prayers have been canceled in more than 20 cities, but also in Saudi Arabia, where tourist visas were totally stopped for the annual pilgrimages to Mecca and Medina. Our lives have changed in these past weeks, perhaps like never before. This is certainly a difficult, strange, and unprecedented time to be living in. These days and weeks are life-altering and even life-threatening for many people. Many of us are praying every day that the cases in the United States and around the world may be plateauing. We don't know if the virus will be affected by warmer temperatures in the spring or this summer. We don't know if vaccines and therapy trials now underway in many places will work. But when we face what we don't know, let's remember what we do know. I have learned in the many years of my life that at those times when I didn't think that God was really there, God was there. In those days when I didn't think that I could go on one more day, God showed up in several ways and gave me the strength to go on and to get through. Nothing about the coronavirus pandemic has changed anything about the nature of God. God is as powerful today as when he created the world and everything in it. God loves you. God loves me. As much today as when he sent his son into the world 2,000 years ago for us. What is important today is that we know that we can talk with God about our doubts in these very difficult days, and know that God does hear us and God does care about us. In the reading from the Holy Scriptures that the deacon read just a few minutes ago, the prophet Isaiah tells us that the people will misunderstand the Savior of the world when he comes. And when Jesus came to Jerusalem for the feast of the Passover, the people were so divided about him. Oh, the common people came out to hear his stories, but they weren't certain who he was. They liked him, and they listened to him, and they took slowly to him. But the A-list people, didn't feel any need for this itinerant preacher who was gathering a following. Perhaps you've heard it said that home is where, when you go there, they have to take you in. Well, Jesus came home to Jerusalem, and the very people who should have known him best wanted nothing to do with him. Oh, they knew the Savior was coming. God had told them through the prophets over and over again. Every book, every chapter in the Old Testament tells of one great truth, that the Savior of the world will come. Isaiah spoke to the people about God's plan for the whole world, that the Messiah, the Savior, would complete God's plan by dying on a cross and leaving an empty grave. to show us that when this life as we know it closes in and comes to an end, there is yet so much more for us to experience as we see God face to face and live with Him forever. The Savior's life and death and resurrection would open the door to heaven and the gate to eternal life for all of us who believe and trust in Him. The Old Testament prophet Isaiah tells the good news that we all need to hear, that the Savior of the world would come into the world for every person. I invite you to think, especially today, that you are one of those people that God came into the world for. On that dark, dark Friday, back in Jerusalem, the Savior of the world was betrayed and beaten and crowned with a branch from a thorn bush and then crucified for our sake. And now 2,000 years later comes Good Friday in 2020, in the midst of the worst pandemic any of us has ever experienced. And it's up to you and to me to remember tonight that it was Christ's trust in the promise of the Father that caused Him to put everything on the line for all of us, everywhere. While this pandemic came upon us with very little planning in place, you and I are not unprepared. Even on this Good Friday, you and I are an Easter people. We are an Easter people living in a Good Friday world. We are a people who live with a promise from God, a bold promise, the greatest promise ever made by God, the promise that nothing on earth can ever attack us and win a final victory. Oh, it's Good Friday, but Easter Sunday is coming. And my prayer for you and my plea to you would be that you would depend on Jesus Christ and His promise now in these days more than ever. And also that you would draw near to Him. And as you do, that you would bow your head and pray these words: O Jesus, help me to feel Your nearness. Offer me the strength to get through this time. I can't do it alone, but with Your help, I can. Amen.
Spoken these words, He went out with His disciples across the Kidron Valley to a place where there was a garden. which he and his disciples entered. Now Judas, who betrayed him, also knew the place, because Jesus often met there with his disciples. So Judas brought a detachment of soldiers together with police from the chief priests and the Pharisees, and they came there with lanterns and torches and weapons. Then Jesus, knowing all that was to happen to him, came forward and asked them, "Whom are you looking for?" They answered, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus replied, "I am he." Judas, who betrayed him, was standing with them. When Jesus said to them, "I am he," they stepped back and fell to the ground. Again, he asked them, "Whom are you looking for?" And they said, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus answered, "I told you that I am he. So if you're looking for me, let these men go." This was to fulfill the word that he had spoken, "I did not lose a single one of whom you gave me." Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it, struck the high priest's slave, and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malchus. Jesus said to Peter, "Put your sword back into its sheath. Am I not to drink the cup that the Father has given me?" So the soldiers, their officer, and the Jewish police arrested Jesus and bound him. First they took him to Annas, who was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, the high priest that year. Caiaphas was the one who had advised the Jews that it was better to have one person die for the people. God of justice and mercy, grant us your gifts to extend mercy to those we grow frustrated with, and justice for those who have been disproportionately affected in the current struggle. Give us grace to not respond to fear with anger or violence to violence, as Peter did, but to graciously accept the call you place on each of us in these days. In Jesus' name, amen.
Questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his teaching. Jesus answered, I have spoken openly to the world. I have always taught in synagogues and in the temple, where all the Jews come together. I have said nothing in secret. Why do you ask me? Ask those who heard what I said to them. They know what I said. And when he had said this, one of the police standing nearby struck Jesus on the face, saying, "Is that how you answer the high priest?" Jesus answered, "If I have spoken wrongly, testify to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me?" Then Annas sent him bound to Caiaphas, the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing and warming himself. They asked him, "You are not also one of his disciples, are you?" He denied it and said, "I am not." One of the slaves of the high priest, a relative of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, asked, "Did I not see you in the garden with him?" Again, Peter denied it. And at that moment, the cock crowed. God of all creation, who formed us in your image, help us to always speak the truth, even when fear threatens to overwhelm us. We thank you for the witness of Peter, that even when we falter in our faith, you can use us for your purposes. In Jesus' name, amen.
Then they took Jesus from Caiaphas to Pilate's headquarters. It was early in the morning. They themselves did not enter the headquarters so as to avoid ritual defilement and to be able to eat the Passover. So when Pilate went out to them and said, "What accusation do you bring against this man?" they answered, "If this man were not a criminal, we would not have handed him over to you." Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves and judge him according to your law." The Jews replied, We are not permitted to put anyone to death. This was to fulfill what Jesus had said when he indicated the kind of death he was to die. Then Pilate entered the headquarters again, summoned Jesus, and asked him, "Are you the King of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Do you ask this on your own, or did others tell you about me?" Pilate replied, "I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priests have handed you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not from this world. If my kingdom were from this world, my followers would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not from here." Pilate asked him, "So you are a king?" Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice." Pilate asked him, "What is truth?" After he had said this, he went out to the Jews again and told them, I find no case against him, but you have a custom that I release someone for you at the Passover. Do you want me to release for you the King of the Jews?" They shouted in reply, "Not this man, but Barabbas." Now Barabbas was a bandit. God, who made this world and promises a kingdom that is wholly yours, help us each to reflect your kingdom in all that we do and in every situation, and to speak out against the powers of this world that rebel against you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Then Pilate took Jesus and had him flogged. And the soldiers wove a crown of thorns and put it on his head, and they dressed him in a purple robe. They kept coming up to him, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews," and striking him on the face. Pilate went out again and said to them, "Look, I am bringing him out to you to let you know that I find no case against him." So Jesus came out, wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. Pilate said to them, "Here is the man." When the chief priests and the police saw him, they shouted, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves and crucify him. I find no case against him." The Jews answered him, "We have a law, and according to that law, he ought to die because he has claimed to be the Son of God." Now when Pilate heard this, he was more afraid than ever. He entered his headquarters again and asked Jesus, "Where are you from?" But Jesus gave him no answer. Pilate therefore said to him, "Do you refuse to speak to me? Do you not know that I have the power to release you and power to crucify you?" Jesus answered him, "You would have no power over me unless it had been given you from above. Therefore, the one who handed me over to you is guilty of a greater sin." From then on, Pilate tried to release him, but the Jews cried out, "If you release this man, you are no friend of the emperor. Everyone who claims to be his follower sets himself against the emperor." When Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus outside and sat on the judge's bench at a place called the Stone Pavement, or in Hebrew, Gabbatha. Now it was the day of preparation for the Passover, and it was about noon. He said to the Jews, "Here is your king." They cried out, "Away with him! Away with him! Crucify him!" Pilate asked them, "Shall I crucify your king?" The chief priests answered, "We have no king but the emperor." Then he handed him over to be crucified. God of peace, turn our hearts and our voices from mocking and complaining and shouts of anger. Put instead on our lips words of comfort for the afflicted and praise for you. In Jesus' name, amen.
So they took Jesus and carrying the cross by himself, he went out to what is called the place of the skull, which in Hebrew is called Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, with Jesus between them. Pilate also had an inscription written and put on the cross. It read, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." Many of the Jews read this inscription because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, in Latin, and in Greek. Then the chief priest of the Jews said to Pilate, "Do not write the King of the Jews." But this man said, "I am King of the Jews." And Pilate answered, "What I have written, I have written." When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four parts, one for each soldier. They also took his tunic. Now the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from the top. So they said to one another, "Let us not tear it, but cast lots for it to see who will get it." This was to fulfill what the scripture says. "They divided my clothes among themselves, and for my clothing they cast lots." And that is what the soldiers did. Meanwhile, standing near the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing beside her, he said to his mother, "Woman, here is your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Here is your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her into his own home. After this, when Jesus knew that all was now finished, he said, in order to fulfill the scripture, "I am thirsty." A jar full of sour wine was standing there. So they put a sponge full of wine on a branch of hyssop and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the wine, he said, "It is finished." Then he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Let us pray. God, who gathers us and claims us, give us to one another in this time, that even while we maintain our distance and stay at home for everyone's safety, we will do all in our power to comfort and care for one another. Speak to us as your son spoke, even from the cross, to his mother and to John. Tell us who we should be reaching out to, who we should be reclaiming as part of our family. In Jesus' name, amen.
Since it was the day of preparation, The Jews did not want the bodies left on the cross during the Sabbath, especially because the Sabbath was a day of great solemnity. So they asked Pilate to have the legs of the crucified men broken and the bodies removed. Then the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and of the other who had been crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. Instead, one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and at once blood and water came out. He who saw this has testified, so that you may also believe. His testimony is true, and he knows that he tells the truth. These things occurred so the scripture might be fulfilled: none of his bones shall be broken. And again, another passage of scripture says, they will look on the one whom they have pierced. God, who spoke to our ancestors through the prophets, speak to us now through your Son, our Savior, who died that we may live in grace. Lead us to know your will and to live in it every day, even when we feel stuck. Reveal to us how you might use us to fulfill your promises to all of your people. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you. After these things, Joseph of Arimathea, who was a disciple of Jesus, though a secret one because of his fear of the Jews, asked Pilate to let him take away the body of Jesus. Pilate gave him permission, so he came and removed his body. Nicodemus, who had at first come to Jesus by night, also came, bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 pounds. They took the body of Jesus and wrapped it with the spices and linen cloths, according to the burial custom of the Jews. Now there was a garden in the place where he was crucified, and in the garden there was a new tomb in which no one had ever been laid. And so, because it was the Jewish day of preparation and the tomb was nearby, they laid Jesus there. And now we offer this prayer. God of living and the dead, grant rest to those who are pouring their energy into saving lives and to those whose journey in this life is ending. Give us the courage and gratitude to honor every living being and to bury with dignity those who pass into your eternal care. In the name of Jesus, amen.
For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him.